refer to build your resume or to draft your resume. And then lastly, I'll touch the cover letter a bit, not a lot, but just a bit. And before I dive deeper into these sections, I want to make it clear that resume building is a very tedious task. So don't be lazy while, you know, you're drafting your resume. Also, the more you draft or create, you know, these documents, the more you'll understand how to modify the information and what details to put in the resume. Also, what a lot of people do not know is that big companies like Cognizant, Accenture, TCS, Reliance use application tracking system. So what this system does is this application tracking system parses a resume's content into categories, and then it scans for specific keywords to determine if your application should be passed along to the recruiter or not. So your company, so your resume will only get picked if this resume has a few of these keywords. And these keywords are basically mentioned in the job description. So this is one way that, you know, companies screen resumes these days. Another old school resume screening process is where the HR reads through the resume and decides if you are a good fit or not. So it's important that in both the cases, your resume makes through these steps. So now, what makes a resume an outstanding one? So a good resume is the one that summarizes your job profile. It tells the reader what education you have pursued, what projects you have worked on, what sort of work experience you have, and what extracurricular activities you have been a part of. No one should ever fake anything on their resume. So the HR team members are really very intelligent, and they easily understand who is bluffing and what information is credible. Important point is to make sure that your resume is tailored for the vacancy you're applying for. This means that, I'll give you an example. So this means that if a mechanical engineer is applying for a position in, let's say, automobile company, then his resume should point out his work or his education experience closely related to automobile. But let's say if the same mechanical engineer is applying for a software firm, then his or her resume should point out stuff that is more relevant to the software position. Then this could include any programming languages that, or any online software development courses that he or she did. So that's what I meant tailoring the resume. So the last point and is very important, and I cannot emphasize enough on this. That's why I have made it bold and in red. So that is that a resume should only be made after researching the company and position that you are applying. It's very important that you go through the position description thoroughly, jot down the position requirements, and then start drafting your resume. So this is everything that that goes into making a good resume or outstanding resume. On the other hand, if I say bad resume is very easy to make. You do not have to put any efforts. A bad resume has irrelevant information, is very disorganized, has information copied from other websites or resume. You know, sometimes students' resumes match, especially the summary statement. So this kind of resume fails to highlight an applicant's accomplishments or his actual experience. So no one wants to do it this way. Otherwise, it's impossible to make through the screening process if your resume is like really bad and has these qualities. So the next topic is going to be layout. It's good, or it's ideally, you know, to start your resume, it's good to have your name and contact details at the top of the resume page. Then the first section that comes is in the resume after name and like the contact details is summary. So summary is something that very briefly describes you, and an ideal summary should have what education you have pursued, what skills you carry, what personality traits you'll bring to the company, and what you'd like to do after joining the company. So I'll give you an example to elaborate this. So this is a summary that I've picked up from a computer engineer's resume. So as you can read, as you read through the summary, you'll understand that he has mentioned that he's a computer engineer, which implies that he did his, bachelor's in computer engineering. Then he has internship experience where he has worked on Java and C++, which means he is well versed with these languages, knows them very well. Then he says that he wants to become a lead computer engineer. So this shows that he has some aim with it, some like he's progressive, and he has also mentioned that mentioned the areas that interests him a lot, like let's say driverless car technology and inter-integrated system. So that's how these 3 points he have gelled in into the summary to just brief about himself to the recruiter. So that's one thing. I'll give you one more example. Now here, a chemical engineer with competence in recommended laboratory procedures and productive experience in collaborative projects, specializing in petrochemical process engineering and seeking position as a process engineer with Reliance Limited. Now, you'll see that the sentences are not complete here. That's fine. Unless your idea or what you are saying comes across really well, that's okay. So you don't always have to start, I am a chemical engineer, I have specialization in petrochemical. That's not required. You can just say that you a chemical engineer with like what how it's written here. Just be sure that you are mentioning everything like the education, the skills, your personality, traits that you have in the summary, and then you should be fine. So after the summary comes the section of education and skills. So this should be in reverse chronological order, like the education should be in reverse chronological order and with respective grades and graduation year. If you're anticipating your graduation, I mean, if you're yet to graduate, you should mention that. It's important that you say that you are still a student rather than directly mentioning your graduation date there. So that's about the education. After education comes the skills section. So this section summarizes your technical knowledge, and this is very important. So let's say a computer engineer may start by mentioning programming languages, followed by any web technologies, databases that is relevant to the job he or she's applying. A mechanical engineer can mention AutoCAD skills, MATLAB skills, and any other core software that he or she learned during his education. For example, a chemical engineer again can mention Aspen, MATLAB skills that he picked up in laboratory or during his internship on in a plant or something like that. So it has to be technical. It should come out technical, the skills section. And again, I'm saying this again because it is very important. Every time you draft a resume, it is very important that you tweak it. You order your skills in such a way which is more relevant to the job that you are applying. So this is about the skills and education section. After that comes the most important section. It's the work experience section. Now, how to describe, your work experience? So there is a method actually, or rather a technique I'll say, to write this section. So when a reader or a recruiter reads through your resume, he or she wants to know how good is this applicant overall. That is why when you write the experience, your bullet point should have what you have accomplished in your duty, how much you have accomplished, and how you accomplished it. So this is the X by Y by Z formula. I'll give you an example to make this technique easy to understand. So an applicant wants to describe that he bagged a second place in hackathon. Now this is a bit technical, he wants to be technical by describing this bullet point. Now, a very simple way to put this will be one second place in hackathon, right? but this does not give any information of how he did it or what the hackathon was about, how many teams participated, right? It's nothing. It's just like, it's barely a sentence of like 5 to 6 words. So that's not a very good way to put it. So better version of the above bullet point is one second place out of 50 teams in hackathon. Now, this is better than the previous bullet point, right? But again, this does not describe what exactly he or how exactly he did it. See, so the point here is, if you're applying for a technical position, people like to know or hear technical stuff more, you know, so because it emphasizes on your education or technical skills that you have, and which is important, you should bring that out. So a more better, or rather I'll say the best way to, you know, put this bullet point is, one second place out of 50 teams in hackathon at COEP Fest by working with two colleagues to develop an app that synchronizes mobile calendars. Now, this bullet point covers everything and conveys all the necessary information to the HR in just one line. Isn't it great? I mean, it is clear, right? So you want to describe your experience in this manner. This technique is actually followed by multinational companies like Google, Facebook, you know, Amazon. And if you guys are targeting such companies, if you want to like end up into these companies in your future, it's good that you start practicing this technique now itself. An advantage of this technique is it's very good. And you can apply it to any experience section. So it doesn't necessarily have to be professional experience. So for people who don't really have, you know, like work experience, they can still make use of this technique. They can use this to describe their extracurricular activities. So that's why that's... Akanksha, is there a problem?
No, ma'am, no issue. You can continue.
Okay, I can continue, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So yeah, so that's how the X by Y by Z technique works. So this is one point that you should consider while you're drafting the work experience section. Another point to keep in mind while writing experience is always start the bullet point with a verb. This strengthens your work experience and gives a certain amount of weight to your, you know, bullet point. Then if you have any work experience or academic experience related to the applying position, mention that first. You have to, the work experience you mentioned there have to be closely related to what the job description is. And this point I have mentioned earlier in my, like at earlier stage in this webinar also. So, that is the second point. So for students who are fresh graduates, your academic experience, that is the projects you have worked on and the experience that you have gained during internship, is also a big deal. So make sure that you draft your information properly. Then if you need to create like multiple sections under the same employer to highlight your categories or department of work, then that is fine too. But make sure that you include name of company, the job designation that you held there, and how long you have been working there. So to summarize all these points, I'll show you a couple of examples how to write the experience section. Since I'm a chemical engineer, I did not have any resume other than chemical engineering. So I asked a computer friend of mine to share her resume so I could, you know, use it as an example for you guys. So as you can see, she has mentioned the name of the company here and her position at the firm. So to the right, she has also mentioned her period that she has been working in the firm from. So she has the important, she has three important information by now, the company's name, her designation as software engineer, and the period. So now she has started all her bullet points with a verb. This gives, like I said before, a certain kind of weight to her experience. Now take a look at the second point. She has included her task using the XYZ technique. The point says that she deployed apps to the platform by using so-and-so programming languages and framework, and she has crossed work with teams for this project. So, you know, bullet point brings out or like tells the recruiter certain things about her personality. So she knows one, that she knows the programming languages, she's well versed with the framework, and important point, she is a team worker. So that's how the bullet point should be, or like the sentence should be drafted. That's the aim of X by Y by Z technique. Now, in the second, in the third point, she also had an ongoing task or a daily task to perform, and that she has mentioned in the point number three. So she has drafted, her task is not complete, but because it's, you know, ongoing task or a day-to-day task, she has still mentioned it. So that's fine. Even if, I mean, the accomplishment or the target is yet to be completed, you can still mention it. Because then after your resume gets picked, when you're, you know, having one-on-one conversation with the recruiter, at that time you can elaborate on that topic more and you have something more to talk about. So that's okay. You can use the format that she has used on point number three and draft your bullets as well. So overall, she has done a great job on her experience, and she has done it in such a way that even a layman can understand it, right? So that's basically what I wanted to tell you guys. So I'll show you one more example. So here again, I have started the bullet points with the verb. Now here in point 2 and 5, I have mentioned the accomplishments along with my task, which that is why shows that I have achieved the target and hence completed the assigned task. So that is very important. Also in point number 5, I have tried to use the X by Y by Z technique. And I think it's clear by now why I'm emphasizing so much on this technique, right? So that is how the experience section is done. Now, this was for student with, you know, this was for student with more, who have more like work experience. Let's say some of the students might not have work experience, so they need not worry. They can still use their academic projects or extracurricular activities to showcase their skills. That's fine. But the overall process to draft this section remains the same. Start with verb, include certifications, any online courses or scholarships you have done, and you should be fine. So I have mentioned that I served as NSS, you know, candidate. Then I was a president or secretary at my during my master's education. I also got a scholarship here while coming. So it's important. It's good, right? This you have accomplished it. I mean, this is your success, getting a scholarship or, you know, or holding a position as a president or secretary, because this shows that you have leadership skills. So that is what a company actually looks for in a candidate or the applicant. So again, what I mentioned about technical skills, it's, you know, you're doing something out of different from or more than your bachelor's, just bachelor studies. It's good because it gives a sense that, you know, the student can multitask. He has some extra knowledge compared to other students because you did so many certifications, right? So you can mention that, you know, and this is for students with, you know, no professional work experience. So that's how the experience section is dealt like. So far we have discussed about the content of the resume. In this slide, I'll give you an idea about how the formatting should be like. So for beginners or fresh graduates, try to keep the resume to one page. Students who have more than 5 years of experience can think of writing two-page resume. The recommended margin is 0.5 inch to 1 inch, and you should choose a font and font sign that is legible. Okay, you don't want the reader to use a magnifying glass to read your resume. I mean, no one's going to do that. So they'll just put your resume aside and they'll move on to next. So that's actually one of the reasons why the resume doesn't get picked. So important point is, you know, the formatting should be well and good. The most important thing is proofread your resume, you know. Do not make any spelling mistakes or typos in it, because it is very if you have, you know, it's very simple as it. If you have like a spelling mistake in your resume, the recruiter or the reader will easily put it aside, because he or she will think, you know, this applicant is just careless because he didn't care enough to read through his resume, right? So that's why I said that don't make spelling mistakes. So this is how the resume formatting should be like. If any one of you guys, you know, want to have like more, like get a more detailed idea about how a resume draft should be, or want to have like a guidance for resume building, then I'll suggest you three websites that would guide you really well. So you can find a really good resume template on these websites. Among these, I'll say LinkedIn is more widely used, and you can build your professional profile on LinkedIn. So I advise you all to create a profile on LinkedIn. Actually, Rohit will dive deeper into this topic after me, so I'll leave that to him. So this is basically what goes into drafting a good resume. And please make sure that all the points that I have mentioned during this webinar, you know, you have understood it, and you implement it when you draft your resume. I have tried to go into as much topics, I cover as much topics as I could, and so if you follow these topics, you should be in a good shape to, you know, draft a good or outstanding resume. So yeah, also what I quickly want to brief about is the cover letter. Cover letters are not mandatory, but it's always good to attach it to the resume. What a cover letter does is it gives the employer it introduces you to an employer through a personalized, you know, point of view. So the cover letter does not have to be technical. You just have to be you just have to keep it simple. So resumes are a bit more technical, but the cover letter can be, you know, as an introductory document. So that's what the difference between a resume and cover letter is. In resume, like I said, you use X by Y by Z technique, right? Because you want to very straightly say that, okay, this I have done, this I have accomplished, and this is how I've done. But in cover letter, you need not do it like that. You just have to tell your story through the resume, through the cover letter, I'm sorry. And you can do it by, you know, just mentioning what exactly got you into this profession. Are you liking it? What exactly is keeping you motivated? You know, stuff like that. And so why cover letter is important is because it gives employer a sense of how well a candidate would fit into their company. Does the principles, you know, of the applicant and the company match? Because if the principles match, if your personality matches with the company's, you know, principle, then it becomes easy for the employers there already working there to gel with you, You know, you should be an easygoing person that will make your work easy, right? And their work easy. So that is what you have to convey through the resume. So I'll show you how to, I'll quickly show you how to, you know, draft the cover letter. So this is what a general layout of a cover letter should be like. So you start off with your details, then you mention the company's details, and then you start with the introduction. So the introduction should, it's good if you, you know, start the introduction with an eye-catching sentence. And this paragraph of the cover letter is something that is a little bit similar to how we write summary in the resume section, but it has to be a little more elaborated and with complete sentences. So that's the difference. Okay. You can be a little, you don't have to be, again, you don't have to be technical. You just have to be a little soft, and it has to be like a storyline. Then if you have a referral, you know, that let's say an employee already working at the company has referred you, it's good to mention that referral in the introduction section. So this is how an introduction for a cover letter is written. Now coming to the body part. In the body part, do not copy your resume here. Do not at all copy your resume here. Instead, tell your story in brief, like how you got into the field, what you did so far, what is motivating you into this, what is motivating you, you know, in this field, what brings out the best in, you know, what, like, how do you work exactly to bring out the best in this, in the work that you are doing, you know, stuff like that. So that's how the body of the cover letter is drafted. And then lastly, in the conclusion paragraph, you know, wrap it up by indicating your desire for the position, why you want to work at this company. You know, you can touch in the conclusion, you can touch that, you can touch your personality, like, you know, as it is, as I have made it clear in my cover letter that, you know, I've worked on these departments, and it has given me certain kind of experience, and I think I'll, you know, my experience would really help me to contribute to your company, you know, job that I am applying for. I think I'll be like a good fit for this company. You know, you can wrap it up by saying like this. And then you should also thank the reader for his or her time. You know, you have to be polite, and then mention your contact details so that they can get in touch with you if they really like your cover letter. So this is how your entire application, which consists of resume and cover letter, you know, should be drafted. Again, that I said, I'll emphasize and I'll, you know, say that again, that every time you want to apply for a position, please read the job description, research the company. This will give you an idea what the company is actually looking for, and then it will really help you to draft your resume. Also, one important one advantage of researching the company is when you talk to the recruiter, you know, when your resume gets screened, and when you are actually talking to the recruiter or to the HR or to any technical team, you know, you have something good to talk about. Like if they ask you something about their company, you already know because you have researched about the company. So this also gives, you know, a sense to the HR that, okay, this applicant, he is really interested in this job because he knows the company well, and he would fit very well into this job. So that is why I'm emphasizing on this point so much. So yeah, I have covered resume and cover letter, and that was my part of the presentation. I'll have Rohit continue his part, and after he's done with his, I'll be open for any questions that you may have.
Thank you, Shubhda. Thank you so much. I hope you guys can hear me.
Yes.
Great. Awesome. So guys, I just wanted to start with telling you what recruiters exactly look into your resume. And there is this saying in the industry that most recruiters follow, that we all, the recruiters, the HR team looks at your resume for around 7 seconds. That's not actually true. They look more like for 30 seconds, and then they decide whether, you know, this candidate is fit for a company technical capability wise or not. So what is that the recruiters look for in those 30 seconds? It's basically the past projects that you have done, the past products you have worked with, the past companies that you have worked with, and what kind of work you guys have done. So basically, recruiters go through around 15, 20, 50 resumes in a day. And they know thoroughly about the products their company is working on, and thoroughly they know what kind of candidates they are expecting, what kind of candidates the hiring manager is expecting. So they know everything in great depth, and that is what they are trying to find, whether this candidate is a good fit or not. So they try to find the keywords. They try to find whether you are fit technically and whether you are fit as per the job description. Because in a company, just making a code or just taking readings, if you are in a process engineer, this is not the only responsibilities that you have. Your responsibilities also include kind of collaborating with your team members. Then if you get promoted to a senior position, mentoring your incoming teammates, handling clients and kind of presenting. So this is a whole sort of things that recruiters try to see if you are fit for that. Shubhda, if you can just go to next point. So keywords is the key. Shubhda has already covered this point. I'll just touch upon it once again. So you have job description. The company gives out the job description for your reference, what they are looking for, and try to tune your resume as per the job description. So for every job that you apply, your resume should be different. It should not be the same one. You know, you're sending the same resume to all the companies. Try to kind of make it as per the job description. Use the keywords that you have used. So for example, some people it's a very rude example, I would say. In the job description, they would have given that we are looking someone who has worked on Microsoft Office, and you have just mentioned Microsoft Word and Excel and PowerPoint. So rather than just make it Microsoft Office, and some people will then specifically dive into that we need someone who has expertise in Excel. So mention that thing. So in that way, and this is a very rough example I am giving, but you can then tailor it to your respective fields and respective technologies. So try to mention that. The next. Past experiences is a very important thing that you have to put it. If you have done internships, if you have participated in any events, try to mention it in brief what your past experiences have been, because they try to see what past experiences you've had and try to compare if this is what they are looking for. To the next point. The recruiters and the interviewers as well, they try to find during the interviews that whether you will be technically as well as culturally fit into the company, into the projects or the products that the company is making, is developing. So for example, a company is basically using Angular. This is a CS example. If a company is using Angular for front-end development, and if you have worked on React and little bit on Angular, then you can mention that you have good, not good, but if you have some theoretical knowledge, you can mention that you have theoretical knowledge in Angular and you have extensively worked on React, so that they know that, okay, this guy has worked on React and we can kind of ramp him up to Angular. So this kind of things, they do look into your resume. So please do not try to miss out on these points, and please never think that, okay, you know, the recruiters will understand what I'm trying to say. So you have to be very, very clear on what you want to convey, because recruiters do not have time at all to go through your complete resume. Once the ATS or the applicant tracking system sends the resume to you, they just try to find whether you have worked on similar previous projects as the company is doing and the technologies that they are using. They just do, you know, kind of control find. They just control F, they find the keywords, they read a sentence above, they read a sentence below, and they try to see if this candidate is fit or not. And these days, a lot of load bearing is done by...
Hello. I hope this is better now.
No, sir. It's echoing.
Now is it okay? Hello.
No, sir. I think so. There's some issue.
No, it's fine actually. I think it's fine. Okay. It's going on very nicely.
Yeah, Rohit. I think it's something at your end. You can continue.
Just give me a minute. I'll find another device to connect to my PC. I hope this is better now.
Yes, sir.
Okay, perfect. So as I was saying that these days, every single company is sending you online screening tests. So that is where they will test your coding skills. That is where they will test your kind of soft skill. Companies have introduced psychological tests, psychometric tests as well. So a lot of load bearing is done by these tests. And once they have these results, then they have to kind of not do a lot of work as previously they had to do. So if now there are 100 applicants for a position, they just send one single link to all these applicants. And out of those, whatever 20, 25 candidates who clear the test, that is when they, you know, give them a call, try asking them what are their expectations, and try asking them what they have done previously. Then they try to find a fit, whether you are a fit or not. Should the next point? Okay. So also a lot of companies and a lot of recruiters try to find these things during initial screening as well as during interviews as well. And this point is very important for you guys to understand, that they all try to find whether you are willing to learn new things, new technologies, unlearn previous old habits that you have or not, and change according to the culture of the company, and whether you'd have qualities to lead the project and lead the team in future. So these are some things that they initially get screened. Now, just to give an example of my company, why do they find this? Why do they need this kind of things? Is because there are a lot of technologies that are coming into picture every single day, or every single week, every single month, new technologies are coming. And with technologies, as products change, the technologies behind these products change as well. And hence, every single company wants to be a leader in its own game. And that is why they want such people who are kind of flexible to learn new technologies. And if you are not open to this new learning and kind of unlearning things, trust me, you will not be selected in top companies as well. The next point. So the next point I want to cover is, how do you guys approach recruiters? So for example, if you are searching for any recruiters, just let's take an example for Google. You can just search on LinkedIn recruiters, and you can add a filter on Google, and you'll find a lot of people. One thing that you have to consider is that there will be a lot of teams in Google, and probably the position that you want to apply for, that recruiter will not be looking into that position. So a good way to ask the recruiter is whether you have, should the next point please. So as you can see, I've just created a sample message. You can just ask the recruiter, I'm looking for this particular role, and may I know if you have any positions open for this particular role?
in this case for a data analyst. And if that particular recruiter is not looking for that position, he will say, hey, I'm sorry, I'm not looking at this position. Let me connect with the person who is looking in this position. So do not hesitate, be polite and be calm, give them little space. Do not also, while messaging to recruiters, please do not use shortcuts. I've seen a lot of people using that. For example, they instead of writing please, they write PL or PLZ. Please don't do such things while you are getting in touch with recruiters. This kind of has a negative impact on your overall profile. And be polite, be calm while sending such messages. And try to be thoda sa persistent with the recruiters. If they do not reply in next 2 days, please drop them a message saying that, hi, do you have any update on this? The reason why I'm saying that, be a little persistent, because there are so many things a recruiter has to do. People make a lot of fun of HR people that they don't have any work to do. But trust me, 12, 13, 14 hour shifts they work, and they literally do not have much time to go on their resume. And just to give you an example on what my daily job is, I hire for experienced people at an experience level from 1 year to 10 years of experience with different levels. My day starts with collecting profiles from numerous vendor partners that we have, screening those resumes, sending them test links. If this all people clear the test, then do their R2 screening, schedule the interviews with the stakeholders. Now, most of the time stakeholders decline or the candidate declines. So we have to again reschedule all these interviews. Now everything is virtual, so we have to do double the work. So please be polite, please be patient, and do be persistent a little bit, and if they do not reply, send them a message a couple of days later asking them an update. The next point, please. Also, Naukri is a very great tool. It's a very great website to be on if you are actively looking for a job, because every single company out there has its own Naukri account. Even though if they are not publishing the jobs on the Naukri portal, they do have positions open. Now, there is something known as hidden job market, which I'm going to tell you guys about what that is all about and what exactly that is. So only about 20 to 30% jobs are advertised, be it on Naukri or be it on LinkedIn or be it on any other platform. Rest 70 to 80% jobs that are available for a company, they just try to headhunt people. Now, what headhunting means exactly is they try to find people by going through their resumes on Naukri and then giving them a call and see if they are interested. So this kind of things do happen, and this constitutes 80% of the 80% of the job market, up to 80%. So do not be lazy in kind of making your Naukri profile and being active on it. So also in Naukri, there is a filter in which you can filter candidates by how active they were, active in the past 7 days or active in the past 15 days. And most of the recruiters try to find this kind of people because they know that these people are actively looking for a job change or actively looking for a role, and they will be more interested rather than people whose resumes or whose accounts are a month or 2 months old. So be active on Naukri, log in every single day so that the Naukri portal can convey to the recruiters that this candidate was active today and this candidate was active yesterday, which says that you are open to new opportunities. Also, there are a lot of other tools that a lot of companies are using. Hirist.com and Cutshot.io are two of the great examples. A lot of companies have started using and exploring these tools. These are AI-based tools which kind of give companies an overview of your profile. So for example, in Hirist.com or Cutshot.io, both they use such technologies that once the company uploads a job description, they compare the job description and your resume and they give them a percentage of your fitness. This candidate is 90% fit for this particular role. This candidate is 30% fit for this particular role. So that is why I said that you guys please try to tailor your resume specific to the job descriptions and not make a general single job a single resume for every single company. To the next point. Also, if you get a hold of the email IDs of the recruiters, and when you send them an email, do mention in the body that you have worked for such and such company, and do not make it a long email. They are anyways going to just open your resume and see how fit you are for the company, in the company. But to ensure that the recruiters open your email, please do this one thing. The next point. In your subject line, mention the reference of the person from whom you got to know about this position or the email ID of the person. So the first point should be which position you are applying for. And the second point should be the reference that you've got this particular email ID or this particular position. This kind of gives them a little trust that, okay, this candidate has come from a trusted source. So let us at least look, what this person is all about. So that is why when you email recruiters, do mention the reference from where you got their email IDs. Next slide. At interview stage, when you get shortlisted and when you are actually appearing for interview, one thing that I found in my career is that a lot of candidates are confident during the interview, especially fresh candidates. And even if you are kind of giving them a correct answer, because of low confidence, they feel that this candidate is not fit for us, and hence you are rejected. And the next point. As I've mentioned, sometimes giving a wrong answer with 100% confidence rather than giving a right answer without confidence might get you selected. And I have personal experience in this. I take interviews on a daily basis, and I know how candidates are, performing the interview. So trust me, this is a very important point. But there is one silver lining, one thin line between confidence and overconfidence. Please do not be overconfident, and please do not be rude while giving interviews. Be calm, be composed, and be confident on what you are answering. And sometimes the interviewers, they do ask questions, so give them time to complete the questions. Sometimes candidates are on their toes and they feel very happy that they are answering the question, so they will just cut in the middle of the question. And so this kind of gives a bad impression. Also, if you do not understand what the interviewer is trying to say, please ask them what they mean. Do not go on answering if you do not understand the question. So these were a couple of points that I had to mention. If you guys have any questions for me, especially on what recruiters look and how do they conduct interviews, you can please go ahead and ask me. You can just unmute yourself and ask me the questions rather than typing it in the chat box.
Is it over, Rohit, from your side?
Yes, I am done from my end.
It is really an ex. Actually, I am an extempore speaker here now. Really, I thank from core of my heart to both the speaker, the Shubhda also, and Rohit also. Rohit, at very short notice, actually, he joined here, and he gave such a nice feedback, actually. And really, I'm thankful from all of all the alumni association, as well as from the student side also. Okay, and these inputs are really required. In fact, this type of webinar we wanted to have from long time, and today we had a date. And really, I'm thankful to both the speakers. They have given excellent inputs, and I hope that those students, those who could join, or the recording is on, they'll take the input from there, and they'll write good resume. And as we all said that we are available, if they want our guidance, we'll definitely guide our students so that this is the first stage of writing a resume, the curriculum vitae it is called. It is what you are writing regarding your own
thing, which is, it will give much good, better insight for a recruiter. Okay. Now it will be opened, I think, for a question and answer session. The students, they can unmute and they can start question and answer. Yeah. Sorry, I was the extempore and I joined in between.
So guys, if you have any questions for me or for Shubhda, please unmute yourself and ask us. And please not, I do believe that you should ask rather than putting it on the chat box. No questions?
Looks like Rohit and Shubhda, you have done so well that everything is so clear.
They
nobody
don't have
wants
any
to
questions.
Ask.
If that's the case, I guess then we are glad.
But one thing I would definitely like to point out is please do not hesitate to ask questions during interviews, especially at the end. So most of the recruiters and the interviewers and the panelists, they do ask you if you have any other questions for us.
Akanksha, there is a question in the chat box. You can read it.
Yes. So we have a question here. Is it really worth to do MS? Because after doing your MS, if you end up doing no job, it will take your whole life to pay off the loan. It's asking them by Sanjay Sarangi.
Yeah. So Sanjay, okay. So there are a couple of things that goes when you are doing your master's. So master's usually is, it takes 2 years to, graduate. And during those 2 years, you have to work on to like a couple of things, so that you land up getting a job after you graduate. So you have to be like really active, do all the things that Rohit and I just mentioned, and then it becomes easier to get a job. So it is nothing as such that you won't get a job after you do your MS. You getting a job depends on how much efforts you put into it and how much what you do to build your profile, how much do you connect socially or network. So everything of it goes into it, into getting a job. Even if then, if the market is really down and you don't get a job, there are certain number of other ways as well, which you can, choose to remain in this state till you get a job. And then, once you get a job, you can like just switch to the job and not do the other thing. So it isn't, I mean, I'll say you don't have to worry. If you really are putting your efforts into it, you will land up getting a job. So that's, nothing to worry about.
I agree with you, Shubhda. Maybe I can also add something here. Don't start yourself with negative, because first of all, if you are doing masters, there is some logic behind it, right? And most important is getting internships. If you are here in US doing MS, you get internship. That is the first thing that can land you the job, because I have seen a lot of interns that get job in my company because they do so well that we absorb them. Just one input from my side.
And one more thing I would like to add. I'm also an alumni. So one thing is there is also something called as research-based masters. And that is also something you could try if you want to stay back and extend it until you get your OP1 or try to see that you're getting a job or not. And that research dissertation will also add a lot of value. And most of the times it's because of your research topics, if it matches to the requirement in the company, you get a job right away.
So we have another question. For abroad studies, they ask for good profile. So how to develop a best profile?
Should I answer this? Okay. Yes. So Actually, not only abroad studies, they ask for good profiles. Good profiles are always asked by Indian companies as well. And, you know, if you really want to build a good profile, you know, the best way to do is make the most of the time that you have. So like, so during my presentation, I mentioned that, you know, do online certification or like courses, you know, that are available and related to your degree. So, you know, one way to build your profile is doing that. Get yourself involved into extracurricular activities. Like, for example, when I was doing my master's, I was a secretary for the Graduate Student Association. It's the same way that, you know, BATU has president and vice president. So, yeah. So I was secretary of the association. Later on in my second year, I went on to became a president. And that's how I picked up, you know, leadership or management qualities. Okay, to be honest, I was very like conservative and shy, you know, student during my undergrad. But, you know, as I got myself involved into these activities, I picked up confidence. And now I can say that I manage really well, like people and, you know, other tasks. So that is second thing. Third thing is, if you are an undergrad student, reach out to the professors, you know, get or ask them if they have any projects that you could help them with, you know, or reach out to master's student at the university. Ask them if you can help them in their laboratory work. A lot of technical or, you know, lab work goes on into the company, I know. So ask them, be polite, ask them, can I do this? Can I read certain paper for you? Can I like write down abstract for you, you know? And if you do so, and if the master's student is publishing a paper, and if he's kind enough and is thoughtful enough, he might include your name as, you know, second, third author also. So that is also one of the things that will help you build, you know, your profile. And then other than that, you know, you just have to be really outspoken, interactive, find out every, or like you know, you have to understand or pick up the opportunity that comes your way and really make the most of it. So you can do these three things that I mentioned, and I mean, even these three things will help you a lot to build your profile. I'm sure Prashant sir, Deepak sir, and Rohit will also add more to it. So
it looks like abroad studies is getting more interesting to a lot of students from BATU. I think what we can do is, if there is an interest and if we see that there's going to be a lot of participation, we can have another topic maybe. That will be good, so that topic will cover right from the start, right from basics, college to, yeah, I think we can do something like that. But important is the participation and interest from you guys.
Mm-hmm.
Because, yeah, that's important. But good points, Shubhada, that's really important, yeah.
I think I'll you know, since we are hit with COVID and everything, and in India, especially in India, everything is shut down again, I think what you guys can do to build up your profile is do the online courses. So be it anything, if you are from a computer background, you know, there are certain online courses. I'll mention one site that I refer to, Coursera, and then edX, or yeah, I think it's edX. So these two sites really have like good technical courses that you can go and, you know, learn something that you're interested in. They also give certificates. If you pay, you have to pay like a couple of,
Shubhada, I would like to take that point ahead since you brought that up. So Coursera and edX, they have all these free courses. So you can take these courses, learn new things, but they won't give you any certifications. For certifications, you have to pay. but then they do provide you scholarships, and if you kind of so there are certain courses who charge around 10,000 rupees or 20,000 rupees for the complete certificate, for the certificate, but they also provide scholarships. So they have a simple form, the results come out in 4 days, so just fill in the form, tell them, you know, why you deserve a scholarship, they shall give it to you. And for example, a course which costs you around 20-25,000 rupees, you just have to pay 2,000 rupees. And I am saying this because I have myself done this thing. So yes, you can use these things. Sorry, Shubhda, to interrupt you, but this is what I just wanted to add.
That's okay. That's exactly what I wanted to say, but you got it.
We have another question. It says, as a fresher BTech grad, we don't have much experience to highlight in the resume. So what is the way to make the resume and interview look good?
Okay. Yeah. So I did mention it during the presentation. So one thing that you can highlight if you don't have any work experience is you can highlight your internship experience. Okay, start by highlighting your internship experience. Use the X by Y by Z technique to do that, and then apply it to all the bullet points that you have, and then you should be fine for the internship experience. If for some students, if they, you don't have internship experience also, you can emphasize on the extracurricular activities that you did. Before extracurricular activities, I'll say highlight the academic projects that you have worked on. We have minor projects and major projects, right, in the third and fourth year respectively. So try to highlight on that. I work really hard on those projects. Make sure that you know every bit of it. If you know, if a recruiter or a professor asks you about it, you should be in a position to answer each and every question or problem regarding your project. So yeah, if you work really well on the academic projects, and if you draft it really well in the resume, that should work out for you. And the second thing that will help to build your resume for students who don't have professional experiences, extracurricular activities. So if you have any, let's say during high school or 11th, 12th standard, if you participated in any kind of competition, or if you've been a coordinator for a certain fest, mention that. It's fine. Even if you presented something at the festive, tech fest, that's fine too. So those are the these are the ways that you can build your profile if you don't have job experience. Also, I want to, since you have brought this question up, I'll just tell you one thing. Recruiters, they when they go through a fresher's profile who doesn't really have work experience, it's fine. They understand it. But then what they want to see is how socially interactive or what other personality traits you have. And these traits will get showcased through your extracurricular activities or academics projects. So it is important that you focus on those part as well if you don't have work experience. I hope that answered your question.
On the spot, Shubhada, but I would augment that with a couple of points. One is, like, when we are interviewing a fresher, we very well know that they would not have much of technical depth for the project. But you need to know that some companies have certain principles that they follow. So you should study the company very well, understand what principles they follow, and have that in your resume in some way or the other. So if you go to Google, they have a certain principles based on which the HR works. Amazon has their own principles, 14 principles. So you should showcase those things in your cover letter and your resume. So study the company that you're trying to apply.
The next question is, what mistake did you did while your application? If you can go to past and then you will still pick up the same college? Like, will you still pick up the same college if you can go to the past?
The question was not very clear. I mean, your voice kind of got cut out. Can you repeat it?
Yes. Am I audible?
Yeah. You are now.
Yes. What mistakes you did while your application, if you go in the past, then will you still pick the same college?
Oh, that's a very interesting question. And I will still pick the same college because, I mean, what Batu gave to me in terms of technical knowledge, education experience, social life, I am very much satisfied with it. If I were to go back and change anything, there is not a single thing that I would change because everything was very, very perfect for me. And I think what I did was in my undergrad, so what was the second question? Can you repeat? It was something related to application, right?
Yes, ma'am. It was what mistakes you did while your application.
So application, you mean job application or... I think it's job application, right?
Yeah, they have not specified it.
So, okay. So for job application, I'll say when I first started off, I had one resume and I was applying with that one resume everywhere. And I made like some 50, 60 application and I still did not get any call. And that's when I, attended resume drafting session. I reached out to my, there are international student helpers at the university, so they help you out with your resume, how you should draft it. And that's how I came to know that, you have to draft your resume or you have to always draft your resume every time you apply for a new position. So that's one thing that I implemented in my application process, and post that the response was pretty good. Also, what I did do was I reached out to recruiters like Rohit just mentioned in during his part of presentation. I networked with them. I did not just, got in touch with them for the opportunity, like, I found out that, your company is looking for such and such engineer. I think I'll be really good for it. And then he said, no, I think we have, already found our match and now we have closed the position. And then, I wasn't like, oh, okay, thank you. No, I did not stop there. I went ahead and I converted that conversation into a little more informative one. Like I started asking him, what do you think, how the environment of the company is? Why do you think you want to work there? I asked him some personal questions and that's how I connected with him so much, like so well that, like few of the recruiters still remember me. They still remember my application. So you don't have to be really just, to the point and then leave it from there. You can take it to another level. You can give your direction, you can give your conversation a different direction. And that will help the recruiter keep your personality and your application in mind. And the next time when there is a position in the company, he thinks of you, And so he might get in contact with you that, hey, Shubhada, I remember you contacted me for this position last time. Now we have a similar position open. So would you be interested? So, that is one thing that I did and worked out for me. So, that those are the things that I learned and then implemented in my job application later when I learned it from my international advisor.
We have another question. Is it fine to put hyperlinks to the projects or experience in resume that will redirect the recruiter to the another page that will mention the project work or internship work briefly, since it will help to reduce the size of the resume?
It is a very good question. I'm glad that whoever has asked this question has asked it. It is, yes, you can definitely do it. You should do it. And it is actually a very smart technique, I'll say, if you do it, because it, like you yourself have said it, that it directs you to that website and page, and that website will have all the things that you have done it, and it will help the reader or recruiter understand your project and your contribution even more, or in even it gives like a basically a clear understanding to the recruiter of what you have done. So it's a good thing to do. Yeah.
Next is, what is the minimum number of projects we should mention in the resume, because we do nearly 6 projects in whole BTech.
Okay, so again, you don't have to mention all of the projects, but you start by mentioning the projects that is relevant to the job that you're applying. So let's say you have two to three projects related to laboratory and 2 to 3 projects where you have worked on site or on a plant. Then, and if you're now applying for R&D laboratory, you know, R&D scientist position, then you should highlight, or you should make sure that in one page of resume, your 3 projects that you have done in lab, they get presented firstly. Okay, you have to work really hard to make those points, you know, like give weight to those points. So you mention those first, and even if you skip the rest of the 3 projects that you have worked on plant, it's fine. Or you can make them, you can crisp them and just make it one or two lines. That's fine, and even that is okay. You don't have to mention all of your projects, because when there's one more thing that comes with it, when let's say if you mentioned like the laboratory projects, you know, in more detail and just describe the rest of the 3 projects in one line, once your resume gets picked and you are one-on-one with the recruiter, if the recruiter is really interested to know what you actually worked on the plant side, he'll ask you questions about it, and then you can brief it to him. So that's okay. But make sure that you present the projects relevant to the job, so at least your resume gets picked for that step.
Thank you so much, ma'am. If you have any questions, you can ask to in the chat box, or you can unmute yourself. Yes, ma'am, we have a question. What about speaking English for interview? Like, if someone is not very fluent in English, then what should they do?
Okay, so, you know, as long as you are... see, you have got like good amount of time in your hand, right? You have got 4 years. You do have there are certain ways where you can improve your English speaking skill. So like, listen to watch. I mean this is a little bit, you know, it's a little more a subjective skill to pick up. So if you're not really good at English speaking, but you want to improve it, I'll suggest you to like watch English, you know, some serials or documentary that will help you understand English. And then, you know, the normal conversation that happens, you'll be able to improve it. But by the time, if you feel like you are still a little bit poor in English during the interview process, it is still okay. But then you make sure that you compensate it with your technical knowledge. You know, if you have a good technical knowledge, and at least the technical, you know, the stuff you can bring it across or like convey it to the recruiter, it is okay. I think that should still work out, because in plant or, you know, in lab, you're not going to talk about, you know, anything other than technical stuff. So at least the keywords, or I think the technical words that we use, like, let's say, mass transfer or reaction engineering, let's say, or like some kind of, you know, mechanical course words that you have. If you know that, it's good. You can still work on that. So you don't have to be so stressed about it. But what I'll ask you to stress about is, stress on is, make sure that you make sure that you put solid effort to improve it. So yeah. I think I'll request Rohit to stress more on this topic, and also Prashant sir and Deepak sir.
I think the spoken English is really critical, especially if you're applying to American or even European companies. So we really need to work on them and ensure that, because see, you're that's one of the trade-off, right? You won't be able to speak much with your colleagues, and if you don't communicate or you're not able to convey things, they would not be able to help you in the project as well. So it becomes very critical for them, and that's why communication is really one of the critical aspects that the HR will interview you for.
Yeah, I think I agree completely with both of you. Language is going to be important. Okay? It's a global language. I think spend some time, get at least 60 to 70% perfect on that. That will help you in the long run.
Thank you so much, sir. If you have any questions, you can still put it in the chat box. Okay, I think so. There are no questions. I just have to tell you one thing.
Atharva had a question there, I guess.
Yes. As campus selections have a tough competition within the batch itself, how to reach out to the other companies?
Shubhada, you want to take it?
Yes. So if you want to reach out to the companies on your individual level, the best way to do that is reach out to the recruiters, like Rohit just mentioned in his presentation. So that is actually what is meant by social networking. So, and not just to recruiters, you can also reach out to the employers already working there. So even if, you know, like there is, if they are headhunting, like Rohit said, they will directly reach out to you for any position that is open in their company. So one way to get screened or reach out to company is that. And you have to be constantly, you know, active on the job posting websites. So that's how, you know, you will stand out from the crowd. You know, you have to, for you to get picked up, you have to stand up. You have to, like, you have to give yourself edge to your profile. So do all the necessary things that I just that Rohit mentioned during his presentation, and it should help you in great
And one more thing, if you don't have the LinkedIn profile yet, please go ahead and do it, even if you're a student, mm-hmm. and follow the companies.
Mm-hmm. And one more thing, I think, is MNCs are the ones which basically use the digital media. but there are still few companies who are small scale and available in India, where they don't really use the digital media yet that frequently. So you need to reach out to them either via employees with your cover letters or go the traditional way. So there are still few companies which are small scale, but they don't use digital media that much. But yeah, for MNCs, digital media is the way to go. And have a pruned small cover letter or a quick introduction note, which you can use with all these recruiters. And if it can be in their language, like what Prashant just, Valuri just mentioned, in their French language or wherever you're trying to apply, that will also be good.
Okay, I just have to announce, like especially for the fourth year students, they have to prepare a resume, which we will collect, and we will conduct a mock interviews by the HR department of our, which our alumni. So you can send it to us. You have to prepare as per ma'am and sir suggested. So yes, if you have any questions, you can still put it in the chat box.
Here I would like to just add one point what Akanksha has told. Final year students are requested to prepare their resume as if they are applying for their respective core field and the core job, like their dream job, whatever they are. They prepare the cover letter as well as the resume and drop into the email address what is given into the feedback form. Kindly send it maybe another 2-3 days, and those resumes will be reviewed by our committee. Now Deepak and Prashant Nair is there, so they will be reviewing the resumes only for final year students. Will be after reviewing, we'll be going for they will be giving some corrections where they can add into that. And since this is only a mock interview, so whatever is their dream job, let them you, as if that you are applying for that dream job, XYZ INC, and drop the mail, your resume. The mock interviews will be conducted by the people branch-wise. Branch-wise, there will be alumni and HR expert also will be there, and they will conduct the branch-wise mock interview. Mock interview of maybe 2-3 students, the selective student, and other can attend it. Okay, so that is what is a brief idea for the mock interview session. After this, it was really a wonderful session. What I can see. I could observe today. Thanks again to Shubhda and Rohit, as well as Prashant and Deepak. Those were everyone the nice input for this webinar. Thank you.
Thank you. I just have one more thing to add. So all you guys, I know the application process or, you know, interviewing process is a little tough, and sometimes someone, when some doesn't make through the process or doesn't get a job, you know, you really get demotivated or like you lose all your excitement, and that is fine. But what is important is how persistent you are, how much hard work you put into it, because it is a continuous process. And I just want to assure you that be consistent, be confident, be hardworking, and I have faith in you that you will land, you know, in a really very, very good job. So do not be shy. Be an extrovert. Try to gain as much knowledge as you can. You know, make use of this lockdown period. I think you would all be like at home. So, you know, if you have access to the internet, do as many online courses as you can. Build your profile for people who are having hard time to access the internet. And if you have books, like technical books at home, go through the books, you know, gain as much knowledge as you can, so that when you reach to your actual process, like interviewing process, you know, all these things will help you get a job. And at any point in your process, if you feel like, you know, you want like more guidance, or like if you are stuck somewhere and need something, you can reach out to me. I mentioned my email address in the presentation, so just reach out to me. I might not reply you immediately because of the time difference and like busy schedule, but I'll definitely get back to you. And so do not hesitate in reaching out to me. And thank you. You all have been lovely today.
Now, ma'am, I'll ask Aishwarya to give vote of thanks. Aishwarya?
Yeah. Hello, everyone. I'm Aishwarya, and I'm here to present vote of thanks for the today's webinar. I would like to thank today's speakers, Ms. Shubhda Khanvilkar and Ms. Rohit Babiskar, for enlightening us with their precious knowledge and very important things. It gives deep insight into the topic and reveals some interesting facts. I'm pretty sure that precious knowledge that our speakers gave us will definitely help us in the future. Once again, I would like to thank both speakers for taking out time from their busy schedule and enlightening us with their knowledge. Thank you so much. I would also like to thank DIVA2 Alumni Association team who really works hard to make this event successful. Also, thank you all the students, alumni, and faculty who present here for paying attention and learning. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you all. Best of luck.
Yes, sir. Thank you, everyone.
Bye.
Thank you, everyone.
Yes.
Bye.
Hello. Akanksha, Shubhda, Aishwarya, Rohit, really good day. Okay.
Yes, sir. Thank you,
sir. It was really excellent, and I can say that we overflown today.
Yes, sir.
And you people took nicely that you have diverted the link also, so it is good. So I think more than 140 already joined.
Yes, maximum we reached till 129,
sir. Yeah, 120. Oh, great, great. So it is great, excellent actually. And
we actually created the link at the middle of the session, so most of the people were not able to join.
See, this was last 10 months we are working. Shubhda knows very well. Last 10 months we are working, and we never found this much crowd. Okay. In Zoom, once we got, I think, around 110 something. But thereafter, we never found this much strength. So we decided, okay, this is the good platform, which is freely available, and why to go for the paid thing. So 100 is a good limit. But today it is overflown, and that is a lesson for us. We'll see how best we can go. I think maybe another 15 days when we go online for our with our website, so things can be much simpler. And today's session was really good, actually. Means I personally learned so many things, the intricacies in resume writing, and really wonderful. Yeah. And Rohit also, in a very short notice, he gave his feedback. In fact, we could have added his poster also along with you, so that okay. Anyway, now next is for us, that is resume. Whenever we'll receive, Deepak and Prashant Nair's name is there. Shubhda and Rohit, they can help them for reviewing the resume. And then we can go for interviewing. So we were telling so many times, Shubhda, that we have to review this particular aspect.
Mm-hmm.
And, I rejected so many resumes for internship. because they were not written at all, very badly written, or they have written post-dated, you know, as if they have graduated, something like that.
I agree so much. I mean, the thing is, one of the things about recruiters is that we need to have good problems, and a good problem is when you have extremely good students.
Yes,
and you have the problem of selecting the good out of that. That is a good problem to have. And Prashant, when you start rejecting so many, it's not a good problem. It's a bad problem.
Prashant, you're aware actually. Shubhada is the first girl, Anna, who approached voluntarily for our this activity of alumni association. Told sir, you give me some task, I can do it actually. And she has prepared a document also for how to write her the resume. And we were waiting for this this webinar.
I mean, once our website and all the platform is ready, we should just upload them there as a kind of a repository. And then we just, the thing is, rather than repeat telecasting everything, we can just redirect the students. Just see this.
Yes. It will be.
Okay. Good. Thanks a lot, Shubhada. Thank you so much, Prashant Nair. Thanks a lot, Rohit and Deepak.
Yeah. Akanksha, Aishwarya.
And Aishwarya, yes. Yeah. Thank you so much. I mean, the alumni is here to assist you in every way.
Yeah.
Possible.
And it's good to meet you, Professor Valluri. I think it's the first time that you're virtually like talking.
Okay.
I've conversed with Santosh sir for quite a few times, but it's the first time that I talked to you today, and then also Deepak and Deepak sir. And
probably one thing, Santosh, we can do the next, whenever the next seminar would be there. I think we need to have a bit of a gap, but the next seminar could be on basically the current pandemic. And basically all the things that we can do to prevent it. Yeah. So the next seminar could be on that topic, and I'm sure it'll be good. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Next webinar, actually, we are planning for this one, higher studies. There is a demand from the students. They need guidance on higher studies abroad. So Deepak and Prashant Nair both are there. So they have volunteered. So we'll have it. I made some composure. What should be there means it is not only giving GRE and TOEFL, how to prepare for the exam. What are the finances available and how they should prepare for all those. And then later on, how to select the university also.
Yeah.
So that part, I think they will cover.
Yeah. I think the next seminar could be on that. Yes. And probably the after that, we can have something on COVID. Yeah.
Now we have not. Actually, we have planned to go everything now continuously. There will not be any gap. Now, like every Saturday, there will be mock interviews will be there of different branches. As well as then every 15 days, there will be cybersecurity webinar.
Okay.
And these types of webinar also again we'll add there so that students are getting engaged, because nowadays they are at home only, almost everyone. So every Saturday, Sunday we can rope into them. So that then only their inclusiveness and the association with the alumni association can increase, I think.
Yeah. Good. Excellent. Thanks a lot.
Unko sone nahi denega actually.
Okay. Chalo then. Bye.
Oh, right. Bye.
Bye.
Well done, guys. Bye.
Thank
bye.
You so much.
Chalo. Bye.
Bye, sir.
Bye.
तुमचे दोन्ही शॉट झाले सर.
हा रेकॉर्डिंग बंद करा.